Jay is the original, and Kobe Bryant is the remix.
Ooh. I like that juice.
He took that off the TV. But I saw it on the TV.
We all did.
We all were in the room together. So
MJ said the only player that can beat him one-on-one if he played against anybody in the league would it be Kobe, because Kobe uses all his moves, so it's hard for him to beat himself. So that's, but I'm definitely saying
I just
MJ.
Want to make it clear that LeBron isn't going to be the best ever, so Greaves, get over it, because you're still probably listening when I already told you to stop.
I honestly don't know who. I mean, I guess I'm going to have to go with Jordan for career sake.
Rage sighting.
For career sake.
Rage bruising along.
I'm gonna have to go with Jordan though, because he has more rings. I mean, when it comes down to it, when you think about it, like who's gonna remember what at the end of the day? Yeah, they're gonna remember Kobe's 81 point game or whatever, but then they're also gonna look at the rings. Who had more rings? Jordan had more rings, and he was a star of those teams. He had more Finals MVPs than Kobe did. He had more MVPs than Kobe did. More scoring titles, I'm pretty sure.
He
averaged more points in his career than Kobe. Higher field goal percentage in his career than Kobe.
Never caught a case with any growth.
I don't know. That's because I don't know. MJ's part of something that we don't even know about. So he's never getting in trouble ever.
Kobe.
Hey, look, Kobe is my favorite player of all time.
I don't want to hear anything else.
Just because he's such a dog and he has just a killer instinct. Like, he goes at anybody and he's just heartless on the court. And that's why I love him for real, because he works so hard. Works so hard, and he's just a killer. And that's why he's my favorite athlete for real, because I try to mimic that in what I do. You feel me? I try to work just as hard. I try to be a killer on the field in what I do, just because that's who I look up to.
You just said that you're mimicking Kobe, but you said Kobe's not the best, which means you're not the best. But since I said Kobe is, does that mean I am the best?
I'm sorry, but your career has ended, so.
It never got started. So we're just going to go back. Screw you, Germany Cartel, a.k.a.
All right, so do you guys think that LeBron is in the question now, or do you think he has a chance to be in the question? First, I'll start with, do you think he's in the question now, where his career is right now? Do you think he's in the question to be with Kobe versus MJ? Kobe versus MJ versus LeBron. Do you think it should be like that?
No.
No?
Where he's at now? No?
Only because he's from Cleveland is the only reason he can let him be in the conversation now. So,
only because he's in Cleveland. He needs to leave Cleveland.
Really?
And then he will be, if he would have just stayed in Miami, he would have been there, because, come on now, they would have just kept winning rings. They would have went back to the championship if he would have stayed in Miami, most definitely.
I don't think that if he would have stayed in Miami, they would be talking about Kobe versus MJ versus LeBron. There's no way, because D-Wade is top three shooting guards of all time. Come on now.
With LeBron being in Miami for 4 years, Wade was healthy for a year and a half of that. So, Bron pretty much carried that team. I don't care what nobody say. Bron won them rings, not Wade.
It's Wade County, man.
It is Wade County, most definitely. Wade definitely did do his thing, but you know what I'm saying? Bron won them rings.
Yeah, I don't think if they would have had Wade, they would have. I think they made it 1-1.
Tyler Stoyle. They're not going anywhere. So,
I don't know what Stoyle has to do with the NBA or the Miami Heat.
Oh, we just had him, so I was bragging.
Okay. So do you think he has a chance to be in that question at the end of his career? If he wins a championship this year, do you think he should be in the question?
I think he should already be in the question, but it's different time and day.
Definitely.
I think MJ Kobe is, I think that's kind of where, actually, I think it cuts off in the 2000s after MJ. And then Kobe's kind of from there to here. And I think if LeBron lasts another, you know, 5-6 years, that when he's done, it's him. Yeah. You know, as long as he keeps on putting up over 25 and over 6 and over 6, you know, no one else. They said that he could be the first dude ever to have 30,000 points, 10,000 rebounds, and 10,000 assists. So if you're the only person ever to do that, you might be pretty good.
Definitely.
You know?
Kobe.
Juice, what do you think? Do you think he has a chance to be up there if, like, at the end of his career?
As long as
you think he has a chance to be that good?
I'm not sure, man. Because if he don't win the championship this year, what's the excuse? What's the excuse if he don't win it this year? He got KD Love, he got Kyrie. The team is healthy. Their team is healthy. There ain't no freak accident went on. So if he don't win it this year, what's the excuse?
Well, the freak accident happened to like game four last year, the first round.
The freak accident happened. Just Golden State showed up in the NBA a couple years ago now. We all
No, Steph showed up.
Steph and Clay.
And Klay Thompson is not a top five greatest shooter of all time. Stop saying that, Jose.
You're top five dumbest people of all time.
Oh, my God. All
right.
You really think Klay Thompson, Steph Curry, yes.
All right, so my next question is, do you think that the next best is already in the NBA or is yet to come? Like, the next person that we'll be talking about is up there with Kobe, MJ, Bron. You think that next person is already in the NBA?
Yes.
Who do you think that next person is then, Juice?
Russell Westbrook.
Yes, Juice, I 100% am going to say that.
Hey, I'm 100% agree with you. I'm going to have to intervene, and I'm going to have to agree with the two of you.
Yes.
I just don't want Juice to be right, but it's absolutely right.
Look, Russell Westbrook, man, when I look in his eyes through the TV during the game,
when I look at him, I pause it, and I stare at him.
Here's deep voice.
Hey, I'm actually uncomfortable.
No. You never looked at me like
I'm so uncomfortable at the moment.
But no, though, like I'm serious though. He has that look, like he's just a killer on the court, man. He does not care who he's playing. He's out to get that triple double. Period. Period. Man.
I don't know how he doesn't break his wrist. He slams it so hard.
For real. It's those bionic bands he has on his wrist that break. I swear.
Man, but yeah, Russell Westbrook is a dog, man. This dude, he can do it all pretty much. For real. I don't know what they're going to – how do you think the Thunder are going to play in this playoffs?
They just killed Dallas by 38.
Yeah,
yesterday.
But Dallas, it was a terrible game. It was a terrible game.
Dallas shouldn't be in the playoffs.
Yeah. Utah should have just grabbed that spot. But Kobe dropped 60 on him, so sorry, buddy. See you later.
You did it.
Hey, Juice, how you think the Thunder going to do in this playoffs this year?
They'll make it to the second round.
Yeah.
It's over with after that, because you know who's going to be waiting, so.
Yeah, I mean, they're going to have to either play the Spurs or Golden State.
So they're
not going to
be playing much longer.
Huh?
They're at three. Yeah, so.
Yeah, but they're screwed because.
Yeah. Yeah, so they'll have to play Golden State or the Spurs, which I think one of those two teams are going to win the finals. That's what I believe.
Yeah, yes.
That's what I believe. Yeah, I'm a Cleveland fan. I hope the Cavs win it. I hope they do, for real. But I don't see it happening. I honestly don't.
How about my boy Johnny this weekend? Hey.
Yeah, Johnny, man. What?
You see what came out today? They said that Josh Gordon was at the party with them.
Oh, this
oh wow, man. But I saw some other things about other teams are waiting to see what the Browns want to do because they want to pick Josh Gordon up.
A bunch of teams want Josh Gordon.
But look, though, we talked about this. Like, yeah, I mean, he's failing drug tests for marijuana. Some of these teams that are looking at him, it's legal in their state. So
there.
I mean, hey.
R.I.P. Josh Gordon. Hey.
All right, so we're going to take a quick break here. When we come back, we're going to talk about the D.A.R.E. programs. Everybody remembers those D.A.R.E. programs, the programs that came into your school and tried to stop you from doing drugs, and they just taught your friends what drugs were. So, yeah, we're going to talk about those. Our special guest in the studio with us, Coach Jake, he was actually a mentor for those programs. So we're going to get some insight from him. Montana actually was a mentor for one of the programs, too. What was that program called?
Taking It to the Schools.
Taking It to the Schools. She was in Taking It to the Schools. She was a mentor for that. Yeah. So Just Say No Club, that one, too. So we're going to talk about that when we come back from the break. So stick with us here in a couple minutes. And we got Juice on the music. He's got some bangers for us. So stay with us. Stay tuned. Keep it at 100.
Panda, panda, panda. I got p's in the line.
Just and why my back is so urgent.
Yeah, I like how. In Tiffin, Ohio, WHEI 88.9. You're listening to Keep It 100. I got my squad in the studio and our special guest, Coach Jake. Coach Jake with us. Okay, I don't know what Jose's ranting about now. You want to tell the listeners what you're ranting about now? Okay, I guess not. So we're gonna get into the D.A.R.E. programs. All right. So everybody remembers the D.A.R.E. programs. Well, maybe not everybody remembers them, but they had some. I'm pretty sure they had some version of it in most schools, and it was pretty much to stop kids from doing drugs and stop them from joining gangs too. That was also a part of it. Yeah, can't forget that one, because you know how many kids are in gangs. And but before we start, Coach Jake, what's the actual name of it?
It says Drug Abuse Resistance Education.
Drug Abuse Resistance Education. Okay. And I guess pretty much from what I read, it's they have retired cops or ex-cops come into the schools and talk about drugs and teach the kids about drugs and the effects of drugs and if what joining gangs will do and things like that. And Coach Jake was actually a mentor for the D.A.R.E. program. Jose was actually a D.A.R.E. role model.
Role model.
Yes, he was a role model. So he actually, actually, I'm not going to say it. Why don't you, Jose Sanchez, tell them what you did as a D.A.R.E. role model?
If you remember.
I don't know. We just went to different schools. We always started. Can you guys hear me now? No, we used to go to different schools and just talk in front of different classes, just educate them, go through a bunch of slides, tell them all the stuff they shouldn't do, and they eventually still probably did. So those kids out there that didn't listen to me, good for you. Kids that listen to me, good for you.
Good for you.
High school D.A.R.E. team. Yeah.
We are the same high school D.A.R.E. team, everybody.
The high school D.A.R.E. team.
It's called J-Squared, baby. You ready?
Like stepbrother style. We're going to partner interview this one.
We should have did a skit like that. Oh, my God.
But, no, I, like Jose, I was a D.A.R.E. role model for a couple of years when I was in high school. And same stuff he said, you know, went to schools, talked to the kids, read some stuff off. But the biggest thing I remember was at the end of every year, all the role models got to take the kids to Skate World. We went to skating for an entire day instead of going to school. That was the highlight of it.
So is that why you joined the program? To skip school and go to the skate?
Well, I mean, I got out of school like once a week to go talk to the kids, which, you know, at the time was good until, you know, you told me that I was going to be on the show and talk about this stuff, and I read some facts, and then I figured out that everything we did didn't work.
Yeah. Coach Jake actually came to us with a lot of research. He did a lot of his own research for this and had a lot of interesting facts, really. And it's, like, kind of mind-boggling that they actually had this program that did not work at all. At all. And before he gets into that, I actually looked up the Urban Dictionary definition of D.A.R.E. And it says, a bunch of BS taught by a cop to your kids. So that's how Urban Dictionary feels about the program, and pretty much the results that are in the research, that's pretty much what it says, honestly. So, Coach Jake, what do you got for us?
Yeah, I'll just go through some of these pages. You know, one thing that stands out right from the beginning, it says that D.A.R.E.'s operating budget used to be $10 million in 2002,
wow.
And that fell all the way down to 3.7 by 2010, and one of the reasons was the government did a report that said that the not very effective. You know, kind of the rundown of it is they had the D.A.R.E. program, and one thing was they had a lot of police officers had to do community service, and the community service had to incorporate child development, classroom management, teaching techniques, and communication skills, and the D.A.R.E. program covered this for all the police officers, so every time they went and spoke, they got their community service hours fulfilled that they needed. So when it first started off, everything was good. You know, talking about drugs and alcohol and tobacco and gangs and all that stuff. and then it started to go bad when people actually started doing studies on to see if it was effective or not. And that's where, you know, you kind of realize that it really wasn't too effective. When you go back to, let me flip through these pages here. 1992 was the first study, so that was about 10 years after the program was started. And they probably did the study because they knew Jose was born. but in 1992, Indiana University did the first study on it, and it said that people that actually completed the D.A.R.E. program had significantly higher rates of drug use than people not exposed to the program.
That's crazy.
And then in 1994, RTI International had a bunch of scientists do another study about that, and they said that D.A.R.E.'s long-term effect could not be determined, but then it also says that one of the issues was that a lot of the kids that they were talking to in fourth and sixth grade had no idea what these drugs were even called. And so when they told them, hey, this is, you know, whatever the drug is, they got interested in trying to figure out, hey, what actually is this drug other than the name? And that's how a lot of the youth started. But one big thing here that has a little, I guess, corruption to it was after all the studies and everything came out, an organization spent $41,000 to try to prevent it from being the study from being distributed out to the media. So nobody knew that D.A.R.E. wasn't really working.
That's crazy.
And then from there on, there was studies done by California Department of Education, the National Institute of Justice, American Psychological Association. There's studies done like every couple of years and just keeps on proving that it's one of the most effective primary prevention programs in the U.S. So some that's definitely started off with good intentions, and you know I bet it probably worked for the first couple of years, but now it's got to the point now where they've had to write a couple new like course load things, curriculums, and it's just not working right now.
Yeah, and like something you said about like it pretty much teaching the kids the names of the drugs and showing them what they were, that's kind of how I felt about it. Like I didn't really know a lot of these things until they came in and taught us about them, really. You know, showed us what they were, showed us the effects of them. Whatever it was, like a lot of us didn't know about any of this until they came into the schools. So, I mean, I just feel like that part's a little crazy there because, I mean, yeah, they have these programs or whatever, and it's not like they kept, because I forgot about them, honestly, until just recently. So it's not like they kept up with it or anything like that. So once you just teach the kids about it and then you just stop doing it, obviously they're going to still know about it. You're in high school or whatever it is, you're gonna have friends or people out there that are doing these drugs. So you're going to be curious. If these programs are not keeping up, you're going to be curious. And if nobody's continuously in your ear, you know, as a kid, you're curious, you want to see what it really does, you want to see if those effects were true, whatever it is, you might end up trying it. So I think that is just, I think that the programs are just a waste of money. I don't even know, honestly.
Is it still around?
It seems like it's, yeah, they still have a website and everything, but they've kind of adopted a new way to go about things. It says here in 2009 they started a new curriculum called Keeping It Real. And ooh, keeping
not
it
keeping
real,
it 100 not keeping
yeah,
it 100
not
no,
it.
Hey, no relation.
It says rather than solely focusing on alcohol and drugs, Keeping It Real focuses more on learning theory and life skills with different substance and resistance and different situations, I guess it's getting more away from what actually the drugs are to how to handle certain situations and real life things that might happen, you know, which I guess might be better. But there's a thing at the bottom here, the last thing on the article says, following the passing of Washington's Initiative 502 that legalized cannabis consumption in Washington, the D.A.R.E. program changed its curriculum in the state to completely leave out anything about cannabis for the next 5 years. And one reason they said was research has found that teaching children about drugs with which they have never heard of before or have no real-life understanding may stimulate their interest and curiosity about that substance. So they said since it's legal in Washington to have cannabis and marijuana, that they didn't want to ever mention it to the little kids because they worried that they would already be interested at an early age to figure out what it was and start using it. Yeah, everything that we looked at and research said that it didn't serve its purpose that well.
Why don't they have a program to stop kids from smoking cigarettes and doing tobacco? That, I feel like that's killing people. That's really killing people. Why don't you? Yeah, they should have a program about stopping kids from doing tobacco, because I think there are a lot of like young kids now like doing chewing tobacco. Jose Sanchez. But there's a lot of like younger males chewing tobacco and things like that now, and I think that's, you know, really unhealthy. If you want to really have some effect, then show them what that does.
Yeah, you would think that they'd start attacking things that are, you know, readily available to kids at a younger age.
Yeah.
You know, like, I guarantee when I was in school, half my friends' parents smoke cigarettes.
Yeah.
You know, if you're a young kid, you can just grab that anytime you want. Same thing with, you know, alcohol. If you're growing up, there's alcohol in the refrigerator.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they should start attacking that rather than stuff that, you know, like, in my, I don't know about you guys, where you guys grew up and everything, but I didn't see, you know, drugs or marijuana in person until I got to high school.
Mm-hmm.
I was taught about it in fourth or sixth grade.
Right.
You yeah, know, exactly. So there went 3 years where they didn't teach me anything about mm-hmm. it, you know? So when I got to high school, you know, that was like the first time you see it, you hear it, you know, because when they teach you, when you're in fourth grade, they teach you about drugs. Who's really going out there as an 8-year-old, yeah. you know, doing that type of stuff. So, you know, maybe they should have pushed the D.A.R.E. program back a couple of years, yeah. you know, or maybe it should have been targeted more for just the stuff that you're going to see in a normal household.
Yeah. But I think, honestly, now, in 2016, I think it would actually be a good idea to have, I guess not a good idea, but I think it would be better for them to be start in fourth grade now in 2016. Because there
nowadays,
are a lot of
yeah.
kids. Yeah,
nowadays, shoot.
Yeah, these young kids are getting into whatever. And I feel like a lot of it is from a lot of
dang
kids. The internet, but kids having kids. There's a lot of young parents out here, you feel me, that don't exactly know what it's like to be a parent. They don't exactly know what to teach their kid.
So it's like, they're kids themselves.
Not trying to knock you, Jose.
I love Kellen.
But I'm just saying, a lot of that has to do with that, though. A lot of these parents don't know how to teach their kids not to do something when they're probably doing it. So, I mean, I don't know. I think that it would be better off today, honestly, but, man, it's just crazy to see how something like that, that had so much money pumped into it by the government, just did not work. And it started because of the war on drugs. It started around the same time or whatever. It was like, they said that they...
1983 in LA, the LAPD started.
Yeah, so, man. So, yeah, we need to start getting some tobacco-free mentors. Because Jay, get that started. You started the sack, so let's start the tack.
I hate you.
Yeah. Hey, would it be a show without saying Steve Avery is still innocent? Yeah. Steve Avery
is innocent.
Have you thought about writing him yet?
Yeah, I have a note in my room to write to him. I have a note to write to him and to Kobe.
Maybe we should just start a pen pal program.
Hey, those are cool. Those are real cool.
I really wanted to start a fund for WrestleMania tickets for his nephew. So I think we should really try to get his nephew some WrestleMania tickets.
Hey, got to get the pen pals. We'll have the sack, the tack, and the pack. We in there. All right, so we're gonna head to a quick break right now, and when we come back, we're gonna talk about churches not paying taxes. Do you believe that the churches should pay taxes? Juice doesn't think that we should be on this topic. He thinks somebody's gonna come whack us.
I said that too in the car whenever we first discussed it.
But we're gonna have this discussion. Coach Jay got some research, so we're not gonna waste this man's time. He came into the studio, and we're gonna keep it 100. So hit that beat, and we'll be back with you in a second.
Man, I can understand how it might be kind of hard. I have it,
and we're back with you here in
Tiffin, Ohio.
WHEI 88.9 broadcasting live from Heidelberg University in Tiffin, Ohio. We got Jose. He still thinks the song is on. So All right, so everybody wants to just join on that, you know. Maybe you guys should join Rihanna's next tour. You're right. All right, so
living, she's not dead.
Wow. So we got our special guest in the building, Coach Jake, and we're gonna talk about how churches don't pay taxes. Do you believe that the churches should pay taxes? First off, Coach Jake, that's my question to you.
Truth, you know, myself, I'm not too much of a church-going fella, as I would say. But I don't understand how they could pay taxes when their revenue and all their stuff comes from, like, charities. Mm. So, I mean, that kind of be BS to be like, hey, here's a bunch of money, but we're going to tax you on that free money we just gave you, you know? So I don't know. I don't understand how they could tax it if the churches aren't actually making money. Like, if they were selling tickets to come to church, then yeah, I guess. But, mm-hmm. you know, all that money's coming from state and local federal governments to even fund the churches to get them running. So I don't know how the heck they could possibly tax them.
So do you think if they looked at, like, the money that the churches got from their members, if they looked at that and set, like, set a goal for each church based on their members, based on what they've been getting, based on pretty much what the church has put down, because let's be honest there, everything might not get written down.
You move a couple benches, probably a stack of money somewhere in there.
Yeah, exactly. So do you think that they could put, like, a goal for each one and then like tax the money they get from the members?
I mean, they could, but, you know, it kind of sounds a little bit like, I don't know how they could do that. You know, you look at some churches and, you know, the ones that are on TV and stuff.
Yeah.
And those guys are getting paid, you know, some of those guys you see on TV are getting paid like $1 million.
Yeah.
You know, exactly. Then you get some of the churches, you know, whether it's in inner cities or just small towns where, you know, the church looks like it holds 40 people. I don't know how the heck you're going to tax them.
Yeah. And see, I just don't really, well, before I get on my take, you guys, does anybody else have an opinion on this topic? Juice, you don't want to say anything because you don't want to get whacked. But
I don't question anything that has to do with God. So
you don't have to question me.
With the taxing of the churches, I let the churches do their thing, man. I know it's corruption. We all know it's corruption, just like it's corruption in the government. But, like, you see the TV shows, people who come from the government, what happened? So just leave it alone, man.
I'm doing research on some churches now. And I think the best combo you could get, if you get their double chicken and cheese, with their mac and cheese bites, but they also got this sauce.
Is that church's chicken?
Yeah, they got this honey mustard that looked like it smacked, too. The ranch looks straight, though.
But no, though, like, I just don't think that it's fair that all these preachers, not all these preachers, I cannot say that, because it's definitely a small group of preachers that are just living lavish.
Oh, the preachers of LA.
Living lavish.
They should tax those people.
Yeah, definitely.
They should tax the people they're paying.
You know it's a TV show about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I know, exactly. Okay. How do you have these TV shows about these preachers making all this money, and you're preaching to the poor? Like, you're preaching to people that don't have it, are trying to get something, are trying to do something better, have a better life, but you just whipping corners on a Maserati, pulling up in the parking lot to the church. Like, come on now. What example is that setting? I don't think it's setting a good example. Like, you're preaching to people, and now they see what you got, and now they want that instead of wanting what God wants for them, which I don't really get it. Yeah. Oh yeah.
Money does not buy happiness. If anyone Will is listening, money still does not buy happiness. It is the root of all evil.
Will and Juice.
Yeah, and Juice.
Yeah, I just think it's crazy. Like, I don't understand, and I think that I don't know if churches should necessarily be taxed, but I don't think these preachers should be making crazy amounts of money. I don't think that at all.
And not all do.
Yeah, not all do, of course. Some of them don't make any money, for real. The ones that barely have anybody that goes in their church, and they still wake up every morning to do that. To do that. You feel me? And it's just, and they're not even making anything off of it. So I think, I don't know. Some of these preachers need to get real.
Yeah, I think they should be taxing those guys and not the actual church itself.
Yeah.
But some of these numbers they got in here are pretty staggering. It says, like, if he's about actually taxing churches, it says that U.S. churches own $300 to $500 billion in unpaid tax property.
Wow. Wow. We're
talking about, you know, U.S. being all that money in debt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then again, it's, you know, it's a charitable organization. And it says that it's been that way for 200 years that we haven't taxed a church in 200 years.
So, me and Coach Jake are on taxing the preachers and not the church. What are the rest of you guys on?
I agree.
Yeah? Donnie? Start a petition. That's another one. That's another one. Another one. The sack, the tack, the pack, and the cack.
I'm dead.
Juice, Montana, what do y'all think?
Leave the churches alone.
Okay, Juice, we'll leave the churches alone in your presence.
I don't know. I don't really have a say on anything church or religion related. Not my cup of tea to talk about. Too iffy. Too just controversial. You're not going to make everyone happy.
Of course. Definitely.
So why even waste the breath?
No, we're not here to make anyone happy. So, listeners out there, we're not here to make you happy. We're here to keep it 100.
Yeah. That's true. It's another keep you happy show. Yeah.
No, hey, but we love you guys, though, so keep listening, please. All right, so now we're going to wrap up the show. But before we get out of here, you guys got questions for Coach Jake?
Yeah.
Jose, you starting? All right, go ahead.
Yeah, I was trying to think of some good ones. I was going to ask him the first time I went to a strip club, but I don't want to hear fourth grade. So I'm going to ask
him. Right when he became a mentor?
Right when he was a mentor. It's ironic. All the time, the jugs are coming around. This is crazy, Jake. Anyway, if you had to pick one backup punter in your history of coaching to hang out with on a regular basis, who would you pick? And if I hear James Meese, I will kill you. Be honest. Just say my name.
Jose.
Yeah!
I hate him.
Oh my gosh.
Best friend problems.
Wow. All right, Donnie, you got a question?
Yeah, I got one. Am I starting? No, I wanted to know if you started the mullet trend in high school. I saw the basketball picture.
Oh, we have it here, folks. Let's wow. get to it.
Folks, we may be tweeting this photo from our Twitter, so stay tuned, please.
I did not start the mullet trend. Back in the 1980s and early 90s, people did rock mullets. I did not rock a mullet then. But when I was in high school, my junior year of basketball, I did have a legit mullet for 3 months, and it was pretty solid. It's out there on the interwebs if you guys really care about it.
Yep. I got a question. You're my phone. I do got a
question. Hey, and I just want to say that you look like Brian Utter in that picture.
I'm scared.
What?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Utter.
The one, but I got Utter. A mullet.
Yeah.
Brian? His name is Brian?
Yeah.
I
didn't know that. Yeah. Hey, Utter, you got a great first name, dude. I just want to tell you that.
Stick with the last name. Most Brians need to stick with the last name.
Oh, wow. All right, so Juice, Montana, which one are you going first?
Juice.
Who do you think is the best team in the NBA right now?
Cavs.
Wow.
I have to. Wow. Until somebody gets hurt, it's the Cavs.
Yes.
It's bound to happen. No, they cannot. You know what's going to happen? That episode of, 30 for 30 comes out on Cleveland, about Cleveland comes out in May.
Yeah.
And that is, it's a sign that the Cavs are going to win a championship this year. Because if they don't do it, there is no hope for anybody in Cleveland. Because you know the Browns are picked to go 0-16 next year.
Oh, boy. I didn't know they did that thing.
Yeah. They were 1-15 because the guy wrote at the bottom, they have to win one game, right, with a question mark. So they ain't going to win any games. You can't count on the Indians. The Cavs are the only hope, so I'm banking on them. So right now, the Cavs, Juice. All
right. So, all right. Montana?
Okay. Well, since, like, everything I hear is basically football-related, how long have you been at Heidelberg, and what are your, like, what do you think, like, this upcoming season is going to be like for football?
I've been here since 2005, 2006.
Oh, shoot.
Yeah. But I haven't been coaching that whole time. I was a freshman back then.
That's
so,
wild.
Yeah.
So you graduated from here?
Yeah, I graduated from here, and I've been here for a long time. Was a student coach, a graduate assistant to full time. So I think this is like my ninth or tenth year coaching now, tenth year maybe. Yeah. So it's been a while. But this year, I'll tell you, this is probably the best our team has looked in spring ball. The hardest anybody's worked in the off season since I've been here.
I agree.
From days of a different coach to a different coach to now Coach Donaldson, it's by far the hardest and the most effort people have put into stuff. And, we do have a good group of people coming back. We did take, one big loss last year. We lost our backup punter, Jose. So that's a huge hurt for us. We will. I think we're going to have a pretty solid year, as long as our guys buy into everything next year, the freshmen buy into what we got going on. There will be some changes still. The guys in the program now can tell you that there are changes that have been done from the last person who was in charge now to Coach Donaldson. But I think it's going to be a good year for us.
That'll be exciting.
All right, I got a question for you, Coach Jake. What is one characteristic that Coach Donaldson brings to our team that is going to take us to that next level?
I think one of the biggest, I don't know if I call it a characteristic as much as he wants to bring the fun back into playing a game, playing the game of football. Obviously, everybody talks about winning and losing. That's what, rules sports and competition is. Do you win or you lose? But, if you look at last year, one thing we kind of lost basically weeks 1 through 6, 7, 8 up until there was, we weren't having too much fun out there. Every day of practice was a lull. There wasn't not too many people getting excited. When people are enthused and excited, things start becoming, a little bit better. Things are a little bit easier. And when you start having some fun out there, because you're hanging out with the same 130 dudes every day for the next 6 months, if you're not having some fun and enjoying the people you're around with, the coaches, the student coaches, the graduate assistants, the players, to the, the athletic trainers and the people that tape your ankles. If you're not having fun, having a good time, then, football is going to stink for the next 6 months. So I think it's one of the biggest things he's trying to instill in everybody is having that enthusiasm and coming every day ready to have a good time. And, when you're working hard and everybody's working hard, it turns out to be a pretty good time.
Nice. You got another one, Jose?
Someone told me to say something. I was going to ask you. This was my real question. How excited are you to have me on the coaching staff with you at one point?
After just smiling about people. Fun and having fun.
Who actually sent that to him to ask me? That's what I want to know.
That's not the question. That was Jose's actual question. The question I was asked is, ask him about the fifth floor of Miller. Do you have any comments on the fifth floor of Miller?
Well, I lived on the fifth floor of Miller 2 years in a row, my sophomore year and my junior year. My junior year, we had the spot. We had one door completely blocked off, so we had couches in one room that went around the entire side of the room, and then we had still two beds in there, and then the other side of the room. So you can only enter from one side. So my one roommate, we had three roommates that were, like to have fun and do stuff. Like we had one roommate that wasn't really, on the weekdays, if it was 10 o'clock, he was ready for bed. And so he would get pissed because that was the only door you could get in and out of the rooms, was just that one side. So if it was, any time past his bedtime, he would get pretty upset because the door would open, the light would come on, and he'd be in there sleeping, even if it was me and my roommate on the other side of the quad, just because we couldn't get in our doors because we had ours walled off with the couch. But, yeah, fifth floor Miller was the real deal my junior year.
Yeah, we had the trap house up there.
Fifth floor Miller has always been the realest, even when I was here with Q. Big Q as our RA.
Wow.
Man,
that was
I did. I had one bad experience. Actually, I take that back. I had two. When I was a sophomore, I was up there as a bunch of juniors, and we got on a prank battle for like two straight weeks. And so, you'd play video games and do that stuff or whatever. So, you get a call. It'd be like, hey, come down. We're playing a game in, Jimmy's room or whatever. Well, we got on this thing of dumping stuff on people from, if you put your trash can leaned up against the wall and the door perfectly, when they push the door open, the trash can will fall. And so we had that, and we weren't really thinking, so we invited people down, and we thought, like, hey, this is going to be hilarious. And so we had a trash can full of water, like, in our own room. And so when it fell, it landed on the kid, which was funny, but then the entire trash can, like, spilled in our room. So, like, our carpet, our chair, all of our clothes are on the floor. It was completely soaked. So, it was funny at the time, but then again, it wasn't. And then one time, I was on crutches after knee surgery, and we had a tornado come through. And we weren't allowed to use the elevator, so I had the crutch all the way down to the basement for the fifth floor. That was miserable. Nobody would help me. I was just hopping downstairs.
God, I forgot about watering rooms. God, it was fun. We used to take the garbage cans to college.
All right, so that's all we have for you guys today. We want to say thanks to our special guest, Coach Jake, for joining us today. My dude, thanks, Coach Jake. We appreciate you coming to the studio.
Thanks for having me. Had a good time.
Giving us your insight on the D.A.R.E. programs and everything else. And Jose Sanchez, we thank you for being a weekly special guest.
Where does he mean this guy's not even supposed to be here?
He's not even on the show.
No, he's in the pictures. He's in.
As special guest.
Stranger danger. Stranger danger.
Watch out, folks. He's coming in.
All right. At least one a show. At least one a show. So love it or hate it, we won't debate it, but keeping it 100 is just in our making. So we thank you guys for listening to us this Sunday, and come back with us next week. Follow us on Twitter @_keepit, _HUNNID_. Follow us on Twitter. We'll follow back. Shout us out. Everything like that. Oh, and our next two shows will be a live stream. So next Sunday and the Sunday after, we will be live streaming on YouTube. So you can listen to us. And popcorn, we got cameras in the studio. So we'll be... So watch us on YouTube, we might come with some costumes or something like that. You never know. We might change up the game. And also, I do have another thing. We will be keeping this show going in the summer.
Whoa.
We will be keeping this show going in the summer. Yes, I did not want to tweet that yes until we got on the show, but yes, we will be. Still going on this summer. A couple of us will be here.
You know Jose's going to be here regardless. Jose's
I'm always here, man. I'll be here
a couple weekends.
Montana will be here with us sometimes. One Juice, he won't be here with us. He'll be back in
Florida.
He'll be calling in, though. Yeah, he will be calling in.
Yeah, he'll be. Yeah, he'll.
FaceTime.
Yeah.
From the concert, from the stage.
So definitely keep following us throughout the summer and watch us on YouTube next week. Thanks for listening to us. We appreciate all you guys. We love you guys. And follow us on Twitter.
See ya.
See ya. Actually, boy.